Good morning and welcome to Camelback Bible Church. It's so good that we can join together and worship over the computer today. You know, we come to a God who knows us and who sees us and who cares for us. In the Old Testament, Hagar called God the God who sees. And the scriptures say, cast all of your cares on him because he cares for you. So you may be watching this alone or with your family, or you may be watching this over the internet in another part of the country or even in the world. God knows you and he sees you right where you are. And so we can gather together and worship this morning this God who loves us. Let's praise him. Well, this morning we're going to continue our study of the book of 1 Samuel, and we're going to be looking at 1 Samuel 29, and I invite you to keep your Bibles open to that passage. My mother has been steadily declining with dementia for the last several years, and 2 weeks ago, she moved into hospice care. So needless to say, this has been an emotional time for our family as we say our last goodbyes. In fact, we're recording this sermon on Tuesday, and so there's a good chance that by the time we all watch this together on Sunday morning, she will be with Jesus in heaven, where she's always wanted to be. Well, as a family, we've been reflecting on the way that God ordered the days of her life. She was born into a strong Christian family in Brooklyn, New York. She trained as a nurse in the Cadet Nurse Corps right at the tail end of World War II. In fact, she should not have been admitted to that program. When the school asked to put her into the advanced classes that would make her eligible, my grandparents refused. But the school official ignored their refusal and put her in it anyway, and that changed the course of her life. She went on to meet my father at Wheaton College. God called them to serve as missionaries in France, where they were for over 20 years. And then God led them to Chicago and to Amsterdam and back to Illinois and finally for these last months here in Phoenix near our family. So we've been looking back in hindsight and seeing God's hand leading clearly in each one of these transitions, guiding, providing, protecting, leading so specifically and so carefully in her life. Here's this one story that stood out to me. Back in the early days when they were in France, they needed a car for the ministry. And they only had their monthly support from the mission, which was just enough to get by. And so they sent out a letter to 30 different people in America, letting them know about this need. Now, you have to remember, this was before airmail. And so it would take 2 weeks for the letters to get to the U.S. on the boat. And then if someone responded right away, it would take another week for that check to get back to their mission agency, and then a few days for processing, and then another 2 weeks for a check or something like that to arrive back in France for them. So you're looking at 6 weeks at least for the turnaround time in response to this letter for the car. So 2 weeks later, you can imagine my parents' surprise when they opened a letter from the mission and found a check for $1,800. Think about what that meant. That meant that a month before my parents ever sent that letter, God had already put it on the heart of about a dozen people in the U.S. to send in money to the mission that would provide for their needs. He answered before they asked. In fact, that check of $1,800 was a little bit more than they needed for the Citroën that my father had identified. And so they were thankful for that little extra cushion, but then they realized they hadn't factored in the extra costs, like insurance and maintenance and gas, and that extra money wasn't even extra. God knew what they needed, even when they didn't. And we can think of story after story like that of God's providence. So I've been worshiping God this week as I reflect on his providence, his care in my mother's life. The beautiful thing is my mother is not the only one who experiences God's providence. Christian, if you love Jesus, if you belong to him, his providence is watching over your life too. This is the experience of every believer. Many people think of God as a spectator in heaven, watching from the stands and cheering them on. He's up there in the bleachers, and we're down here on the field alone. But that's not the picture that the Bible gives. God is a wise and loving Father who carefully and specifically lays out the details of our lives for our good and for his glory. The psalmist says, "All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." What a thought! God thought about your life in his wisdom and his love, and then made a record of it in his book so that if all his good plans for you didn't happen, that's his reputation that's on the line because he recorded it. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. And it gets even better because God's providence in ordering our lives as believers is part of his larger providence of ordering the universe. The physical world doesn't exist on its own apart from God. It's not like matter is eternal over here and God is over here like two equal things. No. The Bible says about Jesus that in him, all things hold together. In other words, the universe continues to exist because Jesus continually wills it to exist and continually sustains it by his power. God's work in this world didn't end after the 6 days of creation. He continues to sustain and order this world and provide for all creation. Psalm 104 describes God's care so beautifully. Listen to how it describes the way he provides for us. Psalm 104, verse 10. You make springs gush forth in the valleys. They flow between the hills. They give drink to every beast of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. Beside them, the birds of the heaven dwell. They sing among the branches. From your lofty abode, you water the mountains. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of your work. You cause the grass to grow for the livestock and plants for man to cultivate, that he may bring forth food from the earth and wine to gladden the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread to strengthen man's heart. So the picture we have in the Bible of God and his work in this world is of his continual care and sustaining power. He is our ongoing provider in every way. God even directs human behavior. That too is part of his providence. Proverbs 16, the heart of man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. Proverbs 21, the king's heart, the king, with his power. The king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord, and he turns it wherever he wills. Sometimes if I'm cleaning the sink, there's something over in the corner of the sink that I can't quite get with a faucet, and I'll take my hand and put it under the stream and direct the water over to that part of the sink. That's the way God directs the thoughts and desires and intentions of even the greatest among us, the king. So he guides and controls the decisions that shape our lives, our parents' decisions, government policies, our own choices, all part of God's providence. One of the best definitions of God's providence is from the Heidelberg Catechism. Question 27 says this: what do you understand by the providence of God? And here's the answer. God's providence is his almighty and ever-present power, whereby, as with his hand, he still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures, and so governs them that leaf and blade, rain and drought, fruitful and barren years, food and drink, health and sickness, riches and poverty, indeed all things, come not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. Wow. What does God's providence mean to us? How should we think about this and respond? Here's the answer to question 28, the very next question in the catechism. That we may be patient in adversity, thankful in prosperity, and for what is future, have good confidence in our faithful God and Father, that no creature shall separate us from his love. Since all creatures are so in his hand, that without his will, they cannot so much as move. Jesus reminded us of this. Are not two sparrows sold for a cent? And yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. The providence of God. We've taken some time to think about God's providence this morning because 1 Samuel 29 is a remarkable example of God's providence in David's life. We don't read about any miracles here. There's no stones being turned to bread, nobody walking on water, nothing like that. We read about ordinary events. But God used ordinary events to rescue David from an incredibly dangerous situation. And David would not have recognized and realized what God was doing until long afterward when he reflected on that day and said, "Wow, look at how God saved me." In fact, 1 Samuel 29 hardly mentions God at all. You only see God's name twice, and that's on the lips of the pagan king Achish, verse 6 and verse 9. So God's presence is not obvious on the surface. God doesn't announce himself like a politician with an ad on TV. "Look at what I've done." He works quietly through the ordinary events of everyday life, just like he did with David. God was at work keeping his promises to David and protecting his anointed king. So let's learn about God's providence by noticing what God did in David's life on that day. First, we have David's dilemma. The Philistines were attacking Israel. Last week, we saw that this led to a crisis for Saul, a crisis that caused him to crumble. But it's a crisis in a different way for David. To see that, we have to turn back a chapter to 1 Samuel 28, verses 1 and 2, that really sets the scene for this. It says, "In those days, the Philistines gathered their forces for war to fight against Israel. And Achish said to David, 'Understand that you and your men are to go out with me in the army.' And David said to Achish, 'Very well, you shall know what your servant can do.' And Achish said to David, 'Very well, I will make you my bodyguard for life.'" Well, think about what that meant for David. He was now between a rock in a hard place. This was an impossible situation. If he actually followed through and fought with the Philistines against Israel, he would be branded as a traitor for the rest of his life and could never be the legitimate king of Israel. He would always have that black mark. "You joined our enemies." On the other hand, if he refused to fight, then the Philistines would turn on him. You remember he had fled to the Philistines, to the city of Gath, with his men and all their families for safety because they couldn't stay in Israel. Saul was going to kill them. They had nowhere else to go. His wives were in Ziklag. His men had families in Ziklag. Their safety was in the balance. He was between a rock and a hard place. David's plan was probably to turn against the Philistines in the battle and attack from the rear at a key moment and turn the tide for Israel. And this is where we find God's providence in David's dilemma. God did something David could not have planned. The Philistines themselves kicked him out. Verse 4, "But the commanders of the Philistines were angry with him. And the commanders of the Philistines said to him, 'Send the man back, that he may return to the place which you have assigned him. He shall not go down with us to battle, lest in the battle he become an adversary to us. For how could this fellow reconcile himself to his Lord? Would it not be with the heads of the men here? Is this not David, of whom they sing to one another in dances? Saul has struck down his thousands, and David his 10,000s. Achish was gullible, but the Philistine commanders saw right through David's plan. They had learned from experience. Back in chapter 14, we found that David wasn't the first Israelite to take refuge with the Philistines. In chapter 14, when Jonathan led the people to victory, a number of Israelites who were with the Philistines turned on them and began attacking the Philistines themselves. Those commanders remembered that. Second, they also took David's reputation seriously. When that song mentions thousands and ten thousands, it's talking about thousands and ten thousands of dead Philistines. And they saw that David could become a hero in Israel by attacking them from behind. And so they were furious with Achish for being so gullible, and they insisted that Achish send him home. And like a bird set free from a trap, David left. God's ways are so surprising. His providence is often so unexpected. God rescued David with a move that he couldn't have imagined. And when we think of our own situation, God can do things in our lives that we cannot imagine. God can do things in this coronavirus crisis that you can't imagine. He is amazingly creative. The God that rescued David from an impossible situation is doing things right now in the middle of this pandemic. We're probably only going to be able to see them in hindsight as we look back over these days and months and see where it leads us. We'll be able to see that God was doing things in his providence right now that he could not have done in any other way. He's amazingly creative. God completely turned the tables on Achish too. It's surprising because this ended up being a great reversal. David was the one that was in an impossible situation. But as this chapter goes on, the Philistine king was in an impossible situation. He was torn between his trust for David and his responsibility to the other Philistine commanders. And as a result, he was humiliated before all the Philistines for his poor judgment. And he was humiliated before David. He couldn't make good when he had asked David to join him in battle. So God had a way of completely reversing this impossible situation. David came out smelling like roses. And Achish, well, he was the one that was humiliated. You know, Hannah sang about these sorts of reversals back in chapter 2 of 1 Samuel, introducing the book, getting us ready for the things that we would read. Here's what she said. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and he exalts. This is God's providence in action. Reversing things in ways that we never could imagine. And like God so often does, in his providence, he used David's own enemies as part of his plan. This wasn't the first time that he used the Philistines themselves to rescue David. You remember back in chapter 23, Saul was about to catch David when he heard news the Philistines had attacked. That timing was no accident. God's providence. And now the generals who were such a threat to David were the very ones who sent him home. It's so beautiful. God's got a sense of humor. He can make even his enemies do his work. I remember reading a children's story about a Christian woman who was completely destitute and was just praying day by day for God to provide for her needs and asking him to provide food for her. Well, her neighbor was an assertive atheist, and she heard this woman praying through the window, and so she decided she'd have a little fun. And so she went out and bought several bags of groceries, and left them on this woman's front porch, rang the doorbell, and ran around the corner. So the woman came to the door, she opened it, she saw the groceries, an answer to her prayer, and she began praising God. Well, the atheist neighbor came around the corner and said, "Aha, God had nothing to do with this. I went out and bought these groceries. Your imaginary friend didn't do anything." Well, the Christian woman was unfazed. She kept on praising God and said, "Lord, you gave me all these groceries and you used the devil to do it." God has a way of using even his enemies to do his work. God used his enemies to do his greatest work in history. He used the hatred of evil men to take Jesus' life on the cross for our salvation. Like a great judo move, they meant evil, and God used it for good. This is what the Apostle Peter says in Acts chapter 2. "This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men." It was God's definite plan that brought Jesus to the cross, and he used lawless men to do it. God's providence used the hatred of Jesus' enemies to save you and me. And by his power, he raised this same Jesus from the dead. We see God's providence in Jesus' death and resurrection. We see God's providence in David's life, using the ordinary events of that day to rescue him. I see God's providence in my mom's life. And as a Christian, his providence is guiding and caring for you too. You can trust him. Cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you. Lord, we thank you so much that we can open this passage and be encouraged by it today. We see your work in David's life. We see your work using even your enemies. We see your work doing surprising things. We see your work in the everyday and ordinary. And we praise you. We praise you and we trust you. You're a good father. You watch over us with your loving care. Your hand will never leave us. You will never forsake us. And so we worship you and we praise you for your providence today. Amen. Thank you for taking this moment with us on Sunday morning to worship God and open his word together with his people. And I pray that as you go out into this week, you'll have a spirit of quiet Christian confidence, knowing that God is in control. And if you feel God leading you, we invite you to join hands in ministry with us financially. There's a link right under this video where you can do that. God bless you today.